Hi, I'm Dr. Romano. I want to go over with you tonight a very important video. It's sort of on the borderline of organic chemistry and bio, but I'm going to put it with the bio lectures, but you could classify it as organic because you might hit it at the tail end of organic. And that's called the terpenes that we're going to be looking at tonight. If you're not familiar with this, this is a class of lipids commonly isolated from essential oils of plants. There's about 20,000 of them known. And as a general rule, they smell good for the most part. Now, they're used in things like perfumes, and you would have odors of like roses and lavenders. So that you would probably agree smells really good. Food flavorings, they would use it in, like peppermint. That sort of smells good. I don't know if you ever smell turpentine when you mix with paints. That's not so great of a smell, but I like it because I'm always in the organic lab. So for me, it's good. For you, maybe not. So it's used as a solvent. Now, often, and I'll give you some examples in a little while, the terpenes are hydrocarbons. But if there's an O in it, we call it a terpenoid. The way I used to remember it is you got the O to remind you. So if you have an O in it, terpenoid. If there's no O, we call it a terpene. Now, these terpenes are going to be synthesized from two or more what we call isoprene units. Now, this is what we call an isoprene unit. I used to teach my kids, I call it a little fish hook. You see like it looks like a little fish hook? There's five carbons. The reason why we call it an isoprene unit is because this is the structure of a chemical we call isoprene in organic chemistry. Now, let's just look at what one of these look like. Now, as you can see, I put it in red so everybody could find what we call the isoprene unit. So if on an exam I said to you, how many isoprene units are here? What would you do? You would have this trace with me. That's one. Now, whenever you do this, you want to make sure there's no touching. So therefore, don't touch the red. And there's your little fish hook. Now, where the junction is of these two carbons is what we call the head. And if you remember, the longer part is called the tail. So if I said, what's the relationship here? You would say there's a tail here and a head. So a head tail, a tail head, that's the usual relationship. Not always though, but more often than not, we would see this kind of relationship. Which brings me to what we call the isoprene rule. Terpenes are repeating assemblies of isoprene units, and they're usually joined in a head to tail fashion. Now, if there's 10 carbons, and that's the minimum, to be considered a terpene, you need 10 carbons. We call this a monoterpene. If there's 15, a sesquiterpene, and then it becomes really straightforward. Diterpene for 20, triterpene for 30, tetraterpene for 40. If I show you an example, and I said to you on an exam, I could say, what is this? And you would say to me, well, this is a terpene. That's one question I could ask. Or I can say to you, how many isoprene units are there? And then you would do your little fish hook. Even if there's a double bond in it, ignore the double bond. Just look for the fish hook. There's one, no touching. There's my little fish hook. So I'm not gonna go this way with it, but I'm gonna go this way. So that would really be a terpenoid, but for our purposes, you would classify that with the terpenes. Notice, to be a terpene, you need at least 10 carbons, and there's two isoprene units. Boy, do I remember a long time ago, my group at Queens College. This guy, Dr. Baker, this guy was a rough teacher, and it was a 5-point question, and I couldn't believe my whole group got it wrong because he did something like this, and he said, what is this? And when everybody saw this, they all thought it was a terpene, but it was only 9 carbons instead of 10. So basically, it was just a regular molecule with different functional group on it. So to be a terpene, you need to have that 10 carbons. Let's go over one more example. Say I gave you this. This is going to be 15 carbons if you count it. This is going to be a sesquiterpene. And if you look at the fish hooks, you got this. There's one. No touching. And then you got two. This one is a little harder to see. Ignore the double bond. Pretend the double bond's not there. And there's your three isoprene units. So there's three isoprene units and a sesquiterpene. Finally, we come to this one. You might actually recognize this from organic lab. This is called limonene. What does that sound like?
Lemons.
Like lemons. And this actually is in the peels of, say, lemons or oranges. And as you guys can see, there's a chiral carbon here, which means that there would be two different enantiomers. If it's the R enantiomer, it smells like oranges. So that's an easy way to remember it. So R smells like oranges, and the S smells like lemons. So it depends. If you remember in organic chemistry, enantiomers usually have the same chemical and physical properties, but they differ in two ways. What are the two ways? One, the way they rotate the plane of polarized light, and two, the way they interact with other chiral molecules. So as you can see, you might say, well, what do you mean chiral molecules? Receptors. Receptors in your nose or on your tongue, they're chiral. So therefore, it would bind one enantiomer, and then it would bind another enantiomer differently. That's why you would have different smells and tastes. Here, you would use, if you remember in lab, you probably did something called steam distillation. When a compound decomposes easily at higher temperatures, we would use a technique called steam distillation. And we got a really good question in the new issue of The Destroyer on this, so check it out. So here, if I ask you to find the isoprene units, you got one there, and then you got two there. So that would give you your two isoprene units and a monoterpene. I hope this helps on an area that many times you don't even get to in organic chemistry, and certainly you don't get to in a bio. But these are important. So lipids is a huge array of different compounds, one of which includes the terpenes. All right, I'll see you next time. Next time we got a really great nutritional mode lecture that I'm going to be running, like photoautotrophs and photoheterotrophs. You'll be very interested in hearing. That's going to be a tough one. All right, I'll see you next class. Bye-bye.